In this video, we'll explore a whole bunch of modifiers just so you know what they do so you can bring them into your precision workflow. What's up? I'm Jonathan and welcome to Maker Tales, where I'm sharing my maker journey to help you go further in yours. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that little bell icon to never miss an opportunity to keep making. This video is all about a quick fire round through a whole bunch of modifiers that I really think you should know about, as you'll see just how much power they have, not necessarily within precision modeling, but how to add an arty flair into your precision models. Starting from a fresh Blender file, let's go ahead and do a quick fire round of a whole bunch of modifiers, some that are going to be more utilitarian, some of them that are very much arty, and also one operation that I haven't told you about. So let's go ahead and start with that operation. I'm going to invert our selection, delete the camera and light, and then we're going to start with our default cube here, and we're going to go ahead and straight away do it. And the operation is Alt-D. Now, what exactly has that gone and done? Because it looks like it would just be a normal duplication. So Shift-D, like this. But it's not. We've just done something called a linked duplicate. Now, before I show you exactly what this does, let's go ahead, let's open up these drop downs so you just see what's happening right here. So here we've got our cube, which is the first original default cube, this cube here, which is our linked duplicate, and this cube here, which is our normal duplication. Have you seen both of these have the same cube and this one has a different one? What exactly is this thing? Well, this thing here, you can see it right here. This is our object data properties. Remember in the last video of the organization, I said objects are very much like their own collections holding mesh data. Well, that's exactly what's going on here. And what's so powerful about this is if we go into edit mode, they are both in edit mode now, even though they are separate objects. And that means you can go ahead and edit both of these at the same time. Now, to unlink these, you go into whatever you're wanting to unlink, go into our object data properties, and you can click this little button here. This will create a new thing for it. And there you go. Now it's got cube 002. Now let's say this one here, I don't know, there's some sort of modification. I absolutely love this modification and I want this to be a link duplicate and be the same as that one. Well, to manually do link duplicates, go over to the object data properties and you can select it from the dropdown. You can say, I want this to be like the cube. And there you go, it's going to be like the cube. And this will completely and utterly change the mesh. Just be aware of that. So if we were to go ahead and bring in a sphere now. So we'll go for a UV sphere. There we go, UV sphere. Now the UV sphere itself has a UV sphere object data property. So we could go to this one here and say, hey, I want this cube. Never wanted it to be a cube. I wanted it to be a sphere. There we go. Now you can see that the object data, the mesh information that that object was holding has changed to this here. And this is how you can sort of share it along. Now, what's so powerful about this is that you could use this as an object, for instance, for Boolean cutting. For instance, you have a hole that's all over your precision model that's set for M3 bolts or something. And then all of a sudden you decided, you know what, I want to use M4 or M5. You could make sure that all of these were all linked duplicates. And then that way you can just edit one of them and it's gone ahead and changed all of them at the same time. So that's the power of linked duplicates. But due to this feature right here, that they are all so hidden away and you can't really tell that they're linked duplicates, I didn't feel comfortable showing you till right this point where we're almost at the end of understanding how to do precision modeling within Blender. All right, with that now covered, let's go on to a modifier. So I'm going to bring in a cube and we're going to go and do a little edit to it. Oh, I want this actually to be over on the world origin instead of up there because I like working on the world origin. And here we go. We're going to take this into edit mode. I'm going to do a little loop cut right here. We're going to grab these here and bring it down. Now, we already know what's going on here because we know that if we try to send this to a 3D printer, it's going to triangulate this because these are not defined faces. If you can't remember this, we did an entire video for your first 3D print from Blender. So here we need to basically say, hey, I actually want this to be connected in that way, or I want it to be connected in this way, because you can see here it's cutting it in this direction. However, over here, it's cutting it across. So we can define it with edges. Or if you don't really care how it looks or how it's being cut, you can go ahead and just see how your 3D printer is going to see this by going to add a modifier and add a triangulate modifier. And straight away you can see it's going to try and keep things sort of symmetrical, so to speak. Now, I'm not going to be going through all the settings here. You can go and play with these modifiers to your heart's content. But that there, that is the triangulate modifier. Now, let's talk about another modifier that's quite utilitarian. I'm going to bring in a UV sphere that has a whole bunch of faces on it. And I'm going to go and bring up these rings so that they're quite close to each other and bring up the segments. Now, we've talked a lot about merging. And we know that if we take all this and we hit M and we can go merge by distance, we can then go ahead and change this to 0.1. And all of a sudden, things are just like randomly sort of merging to each other. Now, wouldn't it be interesting if this was a modifier? Well, it is. It doesn't have the name merge, though. The name that it goes by is weld. So you click this weld, and now we will set this by that 0.1 of last time. And you can see it's gone ahead and randomly merged a whole bunch of things. Now, this weld modifier very much is a powerful modifier when you're doing a whole bunch of things within the modifier stack, because sometimes between modifiers, it might not have a merge operation in it, or you might want to mix two modifiers together and then make sure that you're merging the outcome of those together. And that's where this weld modifier comes in. Okay, so that there is all the utilitarian stuff. Now let's go into the arty things. So I'm going to go ahead and we're going to bring in a cube once again, because I'm about to show you something that goes very much into the realm of organic modeling, which is called subdivision surface. Now, don't get confused with this here, which is right-click subdivide. Yes, we know about subdivision in this sense, but subdividing a surface is different, because when you go over to the modifier right here, subdivision surface, what on earth has just happened there? Well, in simplest terms, what it's done, it's gone ahead and subdivided it. And then if we go into edit mode, it becomes a little bit clearer. And it uses all these creases, all these edges, sort of to give the weight to this subdivision blob that it makes. So if I go into face selection, select face, and I go ahead and extrude this, you can see what's happened here, right? So I just said all these edges have a weight. So the closer these edges are to each other, the more weight it has, thus the tighter the seam begins to be. You see, it's a very tight seam, and then the more we pull this out, the more organic it becomes. So this is sort of, in a weird way, called box modeling, but not really. This is subdivision modeling. You're going into the realm of organic modeling now. But what I'm wanting to show you is that you can create some pretty crazy things here. And then you could go ahead and use precision modeling to go and give this a flat base. And then you can go ahead and put in your own pen holder or whatever you want into this. But the key thing that I want you to understand is that all of these edges have a weight to them. So if we were to go ahead and do a loop cut now around here and we pull this down, you will see that we've just now added a whole bunch of weight around this here. So this is now a nice sharp corner. Undoing that, there is a different way of doing this. You can go into edge selection. Let's select this edge loop all the way around here. Let's open up our properties menu here and we can see there's this crease amount, edge data crease. You can increase this crease amount, and you can see we get about the same result again, because what we've basically done is said, hey, this crease has a lot of weight behind it. Make sure that it applies onto the subdivision surface. Okay, so how would we go about flattening this face? Well, we could go ahead and add a whole bunch of loop cuts up, or if you want, you can also do an inset right here, and you can see the more insets, the more it's going to be flattened out at the top here. So we'll do another inset, and there it is. So we've just done a double inset, make sure I'm going the right direction here. And now we have a nice flat top to this. Okay, so that is the subdivision modifier. Now let's go ahead and let's talk about quite a fun modifier called the wireframe modifier. I'm going to bring in an icosphere for this. I'm going to simplify it down a little bit to just this. Okay, so we have this icosphere. Now, what is this wireframe modifier? Well, what it does is it grabs all of our edges and then gives them mesh. So here we go, all the way down here, we have our wireframe modifier. We'll click this on, and there you have it. It's gone and turned this into a wireframe. Now, you might want to change the settings here a bit. Usually, I quite like the idea of even. I'm going to make this a little bit thicker, and there you go. I'm going to do an offset outwards or inwards of the shape. You can keep the original shape. You can do a whole bunch of stuff. Feel free to play around with this. But that there is the wireframe modifier in a nutshell. Okay, now let's go on to something a little bit different, which is something called a remesh. Now, remesh is sort of a weird way to call it because it doesn't really do a remesh. Remember, we talked a little bit about topography, which is where all these edges are and the definition of it. Well, this is sort of trying to fix that for people that want to do organic modeling, but it doesn't really do a great job, but it is fun to play with. So let's go ahead and let's click this remesh right here. As you can see, it's gone ahead and remeshed this in some capacity. See, it's got a whole bunch. I'm going to turn off our x-ray so we can see all the faces that it's created and all this mesh that's come in here. Now, I warn you, changing this number is going to give you a bit of lag, especially if you go really low. But what I want to show you is we've got this sort of box look, very much pixelated. You can increase the octree depth here so that the boxes get smaller. You can also make the boxes smaller this way instead. Or we can make this a smoothness, so it's doing a smooth remeshing. Or there's a very sharp way of doing this as well. And then we've got this voxel way of doing it as well. Just be aware, all of this, very powerful stuff. It's interesting to play around with. Okay, now let's go into another strange realm, which is the displacement realm. Now, I'm going to go ahead, we're going to bring in a plane here. And with this plane, we're going to go into edit mode, and I'm going to go ahead and subdivide this. So right click, subdivide, and I'm going to whack this right the way up to 50. A whole bunch of information there, right? Okay, so we have all this mesh here, and I just said displacement. So over here on the deform, we have displace. Let's click this, see what happens. Okay, it's just popped up. Why did it just pop up? Because it's displacing on nothing. Let's go ahead and give this something to displace with. So right here, we're going to hit new. Now you can see it's gone all the way down there. Why has it gone all the way down there? Let's take a look at what it's displacing right this minute. So we're going to click this here, which shows you the texture that it's being displaced with. Yes, it's being displaced with the texture. And it's all black. Well, what we're actually looking at is displacement through a depth map, which is from black to white is the height of what's going to be displaced here. Now you could go ahead and use a depth map that you could find online. For instance, a couple of things that look like this, as you can see, very much black to white, or we can go ahead and create our own sort of texture, and that's what we're going to go and do. So here, instead of image type, I'm going to go ahead and set this to clouds. So straight away, you can see how it's being displaced with this noise of clouds. Now, we can go ahead and change the size of this, and straight away, you can see the crazy stuff that we can get on to do with this. We can change the depth of it, how much detail there is to it, the nebula size of it, or you can go ahead and change this to a color, which gives us some softer colors. Grayscale, and go ahead and turn this to hard, or if you really want, can go ahead and completely change the way that we're doing the noise. So here we can go ahead and turn this into cell noise. There you go, some very abstract things going on here. Or we can change it to Voronoi crackle, probably a little bit too much on that one. Let's just make the size a lot bigger or softer. Let's go with that there. We're going to go back to our modifier. Instead of saying the strength is 1, we can just bring down the strength here to something like that. And you're starting to get the idea of what's happening here. It lets you displace your mesh, and it's very powerful. Now, if you want to go ahead and take a look at this, I've done how to create your own depth maps from 3D Mesh. The link is down in the description or in the cards. But I really suggest that if you're looking into this, there's a whole bunch of videos there to show you just quite how powerful it is. Okay, but with that said, let's go back to our texture here. I'm going to turn this back to that cloud one because I quite liked it. I'm going to go back to here and let's make the power of this quite high now because we have this strange shape going on here. Now I'm going to just go ahead, take this into edit mode, subdivide it one more time so we have a whole bunch of faces. There you go, a whole bunch of faces. Now why am I doing this? Well, it's because I want to show you one of the last ones here. So let's go ahead, I'm going to apply this down. So now we have all this mesh here like this. But if this isn't quite what I'm wanting, how would I go ahead and simplify this? Well, there's this lovely thing called Decimate. We know already that we could select everything, go merge by distance, and we get sort of this decimation look like that. Or if you want, you can make it just a little bit more random by going over to our modifiers, going down here to our Decimate, and then we can play around with this. Let's go with 0.1, and all of a sudden, you can see that it's simplified our mesh all the way down. Let's take this look like that, and it's very random, this. So we're going to go as well with a 0.01, even lower still, and this is how you start to get that sort of low poly effect. Well done for getting through that quick fire round of a whole bunch of modifiers. Yes, there is a lot of them, but I'm sure you can see just the power that they have when they work together. A huge thanks to my patrons. You guys are absolutely awesome, and it's the reason why I'm able to make all these videos here completely for free. And if you're enjoying what I'm making here and you think I am worthy of your support, I would love to see you there too. Don't forget that we have a Discord, and that's linked down in the description. Thank you for watching, keep making, and let the quest continue.